Welcome to Tabby Yuriko's Beginner's Guide for Oxygen Not Included. As the name of the game suggests, oxygen management is very important in the early game, and this is what this video will explain in detail. Later on, we will also provide some general gas management solution, which could be useful for even experienced players. So, after we started a new colony, we would be greeted with some free oxygen packets and some special ore called oxalite, which would continuously convert its own mass into oxygen until it's exhausted. These free oxygen would last for maybe about 3 to 5 cycles, so we should make sure to build our own oxygen source before the free oxygen runs out. If you are playing on the first few playable planets, you would probably figure out the solution to this. It's oxygen diffusers, which spends power to convert algae to breathable oxygen. Each of them can generate up to 500 grams of oxygen per cycle, and the normal duplicant consumes 100 grams of oxygen per second. Therefore, you should make sure to have at least one oxygen diffuser per every 5 duplicant. This sounds straightforward, but it is still common to run into breathability issue due to various reasons. To diagnose if the colony is comfortably breathable, we can click on the oxygen overlay button on the top or press F1 on the keyboard. The majority of the colony should be showing the color of very breathable for a normal colony, but if not, what could be the cause? I will show 3 examples to explain the possible reasons and common traps, then provide the actual solutions. For the first one, we can see the top of the base is barely breathable and the bottom is unbreathable. What's going on? We could also click the material overlay on the top and change the filter to gas. We can see the bottom of the base is filled with carbon dioxide. Does that mean we should try to remove the carbon dioxide? No, this is a common trap. Carbon dioxide is not really the opposite of oxygen, and removing carbon dioxide doesn't mean more oxygen will be produced. If we somehow removed all the carbon dioxide in this case, the oxygen on the top would spread out and fill up all this space, and resulting in even thinner oxygen per tile, making the base even more unbreathable. The root cause is not really related to carbon dioxide, but actually because we are not producing enough oxygen. But if we already have enough oxygen diffusers to duplicant ratio, why would this happen? We can click on the Properties tab of the oxygen diffuser and check its uptime. The uptime is apparently far from 100%. No wonder it isn't generating enough oxygen for 5 duplicants as we expected. There are a lot of reasons why the oxygen diffuser would stop running, and here is a checklist we can run to diagnose the problem. Number 1, check if there are still algae available, especially if the diffuser shows the message "insufficient resources, algae." You should click See All and add algae to the list of tracked resources if you haven't, so it is much easier to see if the algae stockpile is still enough. An oxygen diffuser running for a full cycle requires 330 kilograms of algae, so we better have a few tons of algae prepared in the stockpile, otherwise we better expand and dig more of them. Algae tiles can be easily identified by selecting Organic in Materials overlay and locating the green tiles in this overlay. An important thing to keep in mind, algae is a finite resource, and it could run out in a few tens or hundreds of cycles depending on the map, type, size, and duplicant count. That's the reason why we should prevent printing too many duplicants in the early game until we have secured renewable resource production. The solution into the mid game is to use electrolyzers, which converts water to oxygen and hydrogen. We won't go too deep into this, but if you ever get past the various early game challenges, be sure to expand and find renewable water sources like cool slush geysers, polluted water vent or water geyser, and prepare to transition into electrolyzing for oxygen. I wouldn't suggest dealing with cool steam vent in your first few games because they are more dangerous and cost power and plastic to properly tame them. Back to the oxygen production issue. Once we are sure we have enough algae, the second thing to check is if the duplicant's priority setting is fine. If you observe that the diffuser often has a delivery errand pending after many other jobs, it is time to increase the priority of the diffuser. You could do it by using the priority tool and setting it to 6, or use the duplicant job priority using the interface on the top, and assign 1 or 2 duplicants to have a higher priority to life support job type, which is also a kind of supply job but specialized to a few important buildings, including the oxygen diffuser. If the algae stockpile and delivery jobs are sorted, check if the power supply is stable and if the manual generator needs to be assigned a higher priority. I would also like to mention that the priority system is relative, so the higher priority number should be used progressively but not excessively. For example, with 5 being the default priority, 6 being more important ones, 7 means even more important ones, and 9 means you very urgently want the duplicants to do this job now. If you set everything to priority 9, then the whole priority system is meaningless. Saying everything is important is same as saying nothing is important. In the very early game, although we could only rely on duplicants running the manual generator for power, we shouldn't have too much power consumption either. But there is another common trap that leads to a massive waste of power, which is what I am going to show now in the second scenario. For this scenario, we can see the top of the base is very breathable, but the bottom half is still not looking good. What could we do to improve this? Should we use a gas pump to pump oxygen into the bottom room? No, this is the second common trap I'm talking about. Gas pumps are very power hungry, consuming 240 watts to pump 500 grams of gas per second, that is actually twice as much power as the oxygen diffuser. Imagine if you have multiple rooms and uses multiple pumps to pump oxygen to every of them, you will be draining massive power and facing frequent power outage. They are a useful building in oxygen not included, but should only be used when they are really necessary. In this case, they are not, because we have a much better solution, which is to improve the air circulation in the base. The problem is that we only have a gap of 1 tile wide that allows air from flowing through. And there is an important mechanics in this game, which is the 1 element per tile rule. If a tile is oxygen, then it is 100% oxygen and cannot contain any carbon dioxide, and vice versa. Therefore, this small gap is really the cause of poor air circulation. If we design the gap to have 3 tiles wide, like this, then the duplicants can still travel by jumping on the ladders, and the airflow will be much smoother. I left the game running for a while, and we can see the oxygen starts pushing the carbon dioxide down, and the majority of the base becomes breathable. If we swap the bedroom side walls with another pneumatic door, then the oxygen would be circulated even quicker. By having a wider gap between rooms, we are able to accomplish the same objective as using gas pumps without spending any power at all. Now, if you already have your base built when you watch this video, you don't need to rebuild your entire base, but you can choose to research airflow tiles and place airflow tiles near the gap. Since they allow air to pass through, this is also equivalent to having a 3-tile gap for air circulation. But I would not recommend overdoing this, such as replacing your entire base with airflow tiles. This would require a lot of metal ore, duplicant building time, and duplicants would run slower on airflow tiles than on normal tiles, so it's not a better-than-nothing replacement. There is another major cause that would halt the oxygen diffuser, which is when its surroundings reach max gas pressure, which is at least 1800 grams per tile. If the majority of the base is very breathable, and the oxygen diffuser stops working due to overpressured oxygen, then this is actually a good sign. The oxygen diffuser is designed to stop generating when the oxygen pressure is already fine, so it won't end up pressurizing the base infinitely and give every duplicant the popped eardrums debuff. But if you play for a bit longer, you might accumulate too much carbon dioxide on the bottom that would overpressure the oxygen diffuser. When there is so much carbon dioxide per tile, it's not really feasible to push them away with oxygen. Now it makes more sense to use the carbon skimmer than in the first scenario, but I would still recommend to just dig deeper to the bottom and let the carbon dioxide naturally sink in the pit. It is also a good idea to start the digging to the bottom early, before the carbon dioxide accumulates too much, so the duplicants would spend less time running back and forth to gasp for oxygen. Speaking of carbon dioxide, I would like to talk a bit about gas management. But before that, I would like to mention, don't use the algae terrarium for oxygen production. It's not an upgrade over oxygen diffusers, although it looks so. It requires way more of these buildings to support the same number of duplicant, way more duplicant labor to supply them constantly, and also burns through your water supply, converting them to polluted water. They also don't automatically stop when the base gas pressure is already too high and could potentially overpressure everything, giving the popped eardrums debuff and stressing every duplicant if you're not aware of this. In conclusion, they actually just create more problem for you, so don't use them, at least not in the early game. So, how should we deal with a gas other than oxygen? One important thing to know is that there is no chemical damage in oxygen not included, which means chlorine won't hurt the duplicants, hydrogen won't hurt the duplicants, steam will hurt the duplicants, but that's because it is hot, not because it is steam. Generally, carbon dioxide is the safest non-oxygen gas as it has zero negative effect other than it is not oxygen. Staying in chlorine could give your duplicants eye irritation, which decreases their athletics or running speed, but as mentioned, this does not actually hurt the duplicants. Staying in hydrogen could also give your duplicants eye irritation and often also chilly or toasty surroundings, since hydrogen is much more conductive than other gas. The bad thing about them is most plants you farm for food cannot grow in hydrogen or chlorine, so if there's too much of these stacking in the base, the plants could stop growing. A minor amount of random gas wouldn't really do any practical harm to the colony, unless you are doing some dedicated advanced build that requires a pure atmosphere. But if you wish to remove them anyway, perhaps due to some OCD, or if there is a major amount of gas flowing in the base that could mess up the environment for your plants or duplicants, then I will suggest to use the canister filler. It's a very powerful building, but often not mentioned in old guides, because it got a buff only in November of 2024. So what we can do is to place a gas pump in the area we want to remove the gas, and just pump the random gas into the canister filler. The canister filler initially has a capacity of 25 kilograms, but we can slide it to the maximum of 200 kilograms. Whenever the canister filler is full, or we want to empty it, we can slide the bar down to zero, and then back to the maximum. Any gas that was stored would then drop on the ground as bottles, and can be used later. It is very simple to use the canister filler, but it has a lot of advantages over other popular designs regarding gas management. It does not cost additional power to sort or store the gas. It automatically sorts different gas into separate bottles, and it is foolproof, which means even when there are multiple or unexpected gas types, or when the gas pipes are clogged, nothing will go wrong. The pumping does stop, but once you empty the canister filler, everything will resume working normally. It is also power-free if you want to use the bottle gas later, with the usage of the building's canister emptier or canister drainer. If some oxygen are also pumped into the filler, it is not a problem. You could release them back or save them in case you want to transport them later to be consumed somewhere else. If the majority of random gas are already cleared, and you want to stop the pump from running, you can press Shift then D key to disconnect either the gas pipe or the wire. Or just simply wait for the canister filler to reach the maximum capacity and leave it there. There are many other different designs related to gas management, like the mechanical filter or infinite storage, but they either require some understanding of automation or pipe priority, and can possibly fail when one of the pipes are clogged, sending undesired gas types to the wrong place, messing up the entire storage. And they generally need multiple storages if multiple types of gas are to be dealt with. They are good designs that you could learn later, but for the first few colonies, the canister filler would be the simple, safe, and powerful choice to deal with undesired gas. D The only downside is that it requires occasional manual micro to slide the bar back and forth. But if you can be bothered to do so, it could also be the permanent build for you. If you like the tutorial, you can subscribe for more videos or support me by joining channel membership. Thanks for watching!